Okay, all right, well, all right, now we have just finished the quiz for this part, and I've passed out the test for chapter 4. Now, in this particular week, what you're going to have to do is that you're going to have to do the work that we're going to talk about in chapter 4:10. After you get that done, and that straightened your mind, so then you'll be ready to take the test, because one of the skills that's on the test that we have not talked about yet is what we're going to do in the graphing for today's class. Okay, but the remainder of the class is going to be about systems of equations, right? And there's three different solutions that are possible. One is if the graphs are independent, then they cross, and you can find x equals some number, and then can find the point of intersection doing the y. Okay? If they overlap, if it's the same equation just multiplied by a particular constant, then when you try to simplify it, you end up with 0 equals 0, which means that they are dependent. Both those lines are actually the same line. And inconsistent, you'll end up with 0 equals a number, and that means that the lines are parallel. Okay, so those are the situations. We've already been through that. And I have another little parallel drawing that I found. This is cool. If they're inconsistent, they're parallel. If they're dependent, one line is on top of the other. And if they're independent, they cross. Okay? That help? And so that's that part. Now, all right, we've talked about Cramer's rule. In Cramer's rule, you're going to multiply the negative diagonal times the positive diagonal, and you're going to subtract the two. So it'll be A times B minus C times, or A times D minus C times B. All right, and that determinant is a number which, if we have three of them, we can have the numerator and denominator of the x term, the numerator and denominator of the y term of the intersection, if they do intersect. And if they don't, then what will happen is the x and y's will disappear. And you have 0 equals, if it's 0 equals 0, then you know that it's the same line. If it's 0 equals number, you know they're parallel and they don't cross. And I'm not going over that because we spent a good deal of time last week going over how to actually do those. But that is part of the test. So in the quiz, I think you've already shown you can do that. Now, for the function notation, one of the things that you have is if f of x equals 2x squared minus 3x plus 5, then what does f of 1 mean? It means replace the x with a 1 in the function that's labeled f. And in this case, you would have 2 minus 3 plus 5, 7 minus 3, and f of 1 equals 4, f of 0 equals 5, because 0 minus 0 plus 5 is 5. Okay. So those are the composite functions are the hardest. If you have this as g of x and 2x plus 11 as f of x, then if you have f of g, or sometimes it's written like this, f of g of x, then you replace all of the x in f with all of g and then simplify. And so g of f would mean I take in the x, I replace all of the red f, and I get this, and these two end up being different. They don't have to be the same values. They would be the same if the two functions were inverses of each other, because then it wouldn't matter what would happen. But by and large, those are things that are done differently, and you just have to be able to do those. All right, okay. Okay, any questions on composite functions and the function notation? All right, those are pretty straightforward, especially for algebra 2. Okay, yeah, that's the second one of those. Okay, so now what we're going to talk about is the graphing of inequalities. Now, the graphing is going to start with linear equations. Alright, so if I want to graph 2x minus 3, I start with a negative 3, right here, and I'm going to go up 2 over 1, up 2 over 1, or 1. That's the equal. So that red line is where that equals. Now, this equation says y is less than or equal. Well, there's the equal. If I am right here, can you see this trace line right there? You see the trace line? All right, I'm at 3. When x equals 3, y equals 3, because 6 minus 3 is 3. So at this point is 3 comma 3. Now, if the y equals 3 along the line, this says the y can also be less than 3. Where is less than 3? It's below the line. So that means that I'm in this area. And if I did the same thing with all of those, I would be on this side of the red line if my inequality is y is less than or equal to 2x minus 3. I graphed the 2x minus 3, that's the equal part, and then I determine where is less than, it's below the line. Where is greater than? Above the line. Okay? Now, so then if I graph this one, 5 over 4x plus 2.5. So I go to 2.5, which is right here, and then I go, well, that should have been negative. All right, I mislabeled that. It's negative. All right, so, yeah, it is negative here. See, negative. So now I'm going to go down 5 over 4. If I go down 5, I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and over 4 puts me right there. So that's the line for equals. What does this say? Less than or equal. So what region is it? It's below this line. So that means that right now, this part's out because it's above both lines. Right? This part is in for the blue line, but it's out for the red line. So that means the only two areas that I could be on, well actually the only area I could be on is this area here, for these two. Now this says y equals 3, or y equals negative 3, that's this line, and this says y is, so where's y greater than negative 3, everything above? So I'm below this line, I'm below this line, above this line. That makes that area that all three equations are correct at the same time. Okay. Now, we did that with two equations last year. And why do we have it with three equations?
Because
it's harder. It's harder. But it's the same concept. Okay, so the first thing, which is an Algebra 1 skill, is you have to be able to graph the equation. Then when you look at it, it's really simple. If the side is less, it's below, it's the region below. If the side is greater, it's the region above. And you have to find the one area where all of the equations are true at the same time. Okay, so now let's look at this one. Right. So, y equals plus 0, right? So I go to 0, and I go up 4 and back 3. Or I go down 4 and over 3, And it's that one. Okay, now, I want greater than. I want this to be greater than or equal. So now I'm above this line. 2x minus 12. Minus 12 is way down here, up 2 over 1, up 2 over 1, up 2 over 1. So it's this line. And I want to be above that, so this is greater than or equal to. Now, I can only be on this side of the blue line, and I can only be above the red line, so that only leaves this area and this area, it only leaves two areas. And you notice they're either side of the yellow line? Okay. And so now, what I do, y equals x minus 6, all right, that's a positive 1, so I go to negative 6, and I can go up 6 over 6, because that's 1, then draw a line, and I want it to be less than. And because it's less than or equal, I end up with that right area. If I had put greater than or equal, I would have been in this area up here. I'd have to stop at the blue line, because it has to be above the blue line, and so it would be the area that came down to here, over to here, and up to here, if this said greater than, but it says less than, so it's in this part. Right now, that is, in a nutshell, how you do that particular section. This is a 410. That's 410. All right, so if you don't freak out when they give you the equation, and you graph it as if it were equal, and then determine whether you're above the line or below the line, and if there's no equal sign, then these lines just become dashed lines instead of whole. Okay? All right, so let's look at the next one. My mouse is not working. Okay, so y is 1 half x plus 1. All right, where do I start with that equation?
Plus
1. So I'm going to have a dot right here. And then what am I going to do? Up 1 and over 2. And then up 1 and over 2, which will put it right there. Okay? Now, I think that I can do this. Grab it. Let's see. I have to do it this way. Alright. Cool. Alright, now what about the second one? Start at negative 2, right? And then I go up 2 over 1, up 2 over 1. Alright, so that's going to be this one. Now, the first graph says that I need to be less than, so I'm below it, right? That means that one of these two regions below has to be correct. All of the regions above that purple line are wrong. Okay, now, the second one says what? Greater than the purple line. So that puts it where? That puts it in the upper right-hand corner, right? If I had a mouse, I could get there, but that puts it in the upper right-hand corner. Now, let's look at the third one. The third one says negative 1 half x minus 3, so I'm going to start way down in minus 3, and I'm going to go up 1, back 2, or I'm going to go down 1 over 2. And so I'm going to have this one. Set right that point right here. Got that right? Okay, now this says greater than. Right? So greater than the green line is up here. less than the purple line is down here. So that means I'm in either this area or this area. Well, let me use A and B. A and B. Right? Because I am less than this and greater than the green, I can only be in these two areas. All right, what does the red say? I need to be greater than. What's greater than the point I am touching right now? It's up here. So that makes this area right here the area where all three are true at the same time. We can do that all day. Good. All right, that's all it makes. Okay. And what I was supposed to have done with this thing, I get that line. Can't get that line without a mouse. I forget it. That's even weird. That's even more weird. Okay. So, all right. So here's a few more examples. I don't think I need to do those. Would you agree?
Yeah.
Don't have to do those. Okay. All right. So that takes care of that part. Now. All right, so here is the assignment that you have that I want you to work on. Because this is an important skill, all right, I am opting, if you choose, I am opting to change this 410. Okay, the normal assignment is 2 through 16 even, okay? And I am, if I can get to it here. I think that if you look at this section on page 156, I would like you to be able to do 3 through 12, all of them. On page 156, that's 410. And again, because my mouse is not working, I can't get to actually type that in. Okay. Now, the first two, numbers 3 and 4, are just two lines, which is algebra 1, and the rest of them, all right, I changed my mind again. All right, let's do 4 through 12 all. I have given you the handouts to be able to do those individually. Okay, there's 12 problems, or 12 graphs on your sheets, and you're only talking, I think, 10 problems. Okay, so if you'll do those, you should feel really confident about having that particular part on the test. Okay, and that will give you a chance to look at those. All right, and so if you, now you can do what the book says, which is 2 through 16 all, it's just different problems, but the reason that that the 3 through 12 is that the odd number problems are in the back of the book, so that'll save you time in trying to be able to see, did you do it right? Okay? All right? Okay, now we're going to talk about the next section, and I'm going to introduce 5.1 and 5.2. Okay, so let's turn. Let me get the page number here. Turn to page 174. That listed in the book. Okay, on 174, you see the equation for the quadratic function, ax squared plus bx plus c. You see that? Okay, so we are moving away from linear and into quadratic. What does a quadratic equation look like as far as its shape is concerned? Anybody know? It looks like a U. It's a parabola. It looks like a U.
was thinking something else.
Okay. Alright, so, so what happens is that we are going to look at the equation, and we are going to learn a whole new set of rules on how to deal with this equation. Okay? The linear equation that you're going to be using to be able to do the 410, the plotting and finding the intersections on the inequalities, alright, it's just simple. Look at the last number, right? Put a dot on it on the y-intercept, and then use the slope. Okay, well now we're going to have a different set of rules. So what I want to talk about is the parent function for a quadratic graph. Right? The graph is y equals x squared. This is the parent function. Y equals x squared. So if we took that, what happens when x is 0? What's 0 squared? 0. So that's a point on the graph. That's 0, 0. Alright, what happens when x is 1? 1 squared is 1. So I have a point at 0, 0, and then I go over 1, up 1. But what about negative 1 squared?
It's also 1.
It's also 1. So I go back 1, up 1. And what you're going to find is there's going to be a line of symmetry at the vertex. Now, that's a vocabulary word, vertex. Where's the vertex? It's the either top, it's either the highest point or the lowest point, depending on whether the graph is opening up or opening down. All right, now, what about 2? What's 2 squared?
4.
So from the vertex, I go over 2 and up 4. And then I go back 2 and up 4. And again, this distance is a mirror of that distance for the number 2 or negative 2 comma 4, because both of them will equal 4 when you square the x. Then what happens with 3? Over 3 of 9. Okay? Now, and so what that gives you is a parabola that looks like this. Okay, now the next part's important. If in this equation the a is 1, it's this parabola just shifted around on the graph.
Yes.
Okay? So that's one of the things I want you to recognize, is that if the a is 1, it's just that parabola shifted around. Okay, now let's see if I can go back and use this. I'm sorry?
It'd be funny if you're drawing one of itself.
Yeah, I got an idea. Use the backspace. Okay, so. Alright, that's pretty cool. Alright, now, here's the vertex. The vertex is at where? It's at negative 1, negative 3. And so it becomes x plus 1 squared minus 3. That's what y equals. All right, let's try it. What happens when x is 0? When x is 0, I have 0 plus 1, I have 1 squared minus 3. 1 squared minus 3 is negative 2, and there it is. There's 0, negative 2. Alright, and so all that's happened is that this is graph. So guess what this is called? This is called the vertex form. And the vertex is x minus h squared plus k. If that's, then h comma k is the vertex, the bottom point or the top point of the graph. Alright, one of the things you're going to have to do is you're going to have to look at the vertex form and determine where's the vertex. Okay? Now, so, and we'll talk about that in a second, but when this is 1, after you get the vertex, It's over 1, up 1, over 2, up 4 on both sides, if this is 1. And so all you have to do is find the vertex, and then to draw it, you go over 1, up 1, over 2, up 4, and then over 3, up 9, and then draw your graph. Right, if you get that in your head, this becomes a lot simpler. Okay, so that is a parabola, and the parent graph looks like y equals x squared. Okay?
Becomes
6. Because it would be minus negative, right? So over here it's a 6, and over there it's the, it's whatever the opposite of that is. Alright, so now let's look at another one. Let's see if you can get this far. I'll explain that again. Alright, so if I have x squared plus 10x minus 2 equals 0. That's my equation. Alright, to get the completed square, I take the first two terms and I want half of the middle term. What is it? Positive 5, right? So therefore, I have x plus 5 quantity squared. I have x plus 5 quantity squared. Now, if these two terms come from here, I have a third term, which is 5 times 5. Right? So if I have a positive 25 in this, I have to add a negative 25 so that I have a zero change. Okay? I take half of this, and I can create my binomial. Then this number squared is the extra, it's the third term. I need the opposite of it so that I have a zero change. So now, this answer will be negative 27, and my center is at negative 5, negative 27. That's the vertex. Okay? All right, so let's see if you can do that. Let's take the term x squared minus 6x plus 2. And I want you to create the completed square vertex form. Okay, so what I want to know is, I'm going to have some number squared. What binomial goes inside there? Really easy. Well, yeah, go ahead and write it someplace. Okay. Part is you're going to do what? Take, what's the word? H word. You take half. So this is going to be x minus 3 squared. Okay? But that's a trinomial. The first term in it is x squared. The second term is negative 6x. But the third term is plus 9. So to be able to keep it the same, I have to have a negative 5. So then, minus 7, and now where's the vertex located? The vertex will, because this has to be minus, it'll be at 3, negative 7. That's the vertex. Okay, now I'm going to teach you another one. The line of symmetry is a line going right through the vertex. So, if this is my vertex, x equals what? 3. That's the line of symmetry. It's an equation. X equals 3 is the line of symmetry. Where'd it come from? Came from the vertex. Alright? Now, if I have an x of 0, then what I have here, before I changed it, I have 0, 2 as the y-intercept. Because the y-intercept is where x equals 0. So if I take that before I started, when x is 0, y is 2. That's the point on the graph. All right, and because this is 1, if I go over 1, up 1, I have a point on the graph. If I go back 1, up 1, I have a point on the graph. And now I have 1, 2, 3, 4 points that I can graph on my chart, on my coordinate plane, and I should be able to sketch that pretty easily. Okay? Now, later on, what you're going to be asked to do is create the vertex form, give me the vertex, and the line of symmetry, and the y-intercept. Yeah. All right, so that's real easy, isn't it? All right, you know why it was easy? It's because the middle term was even. And so when you divided it by 2, it became even. So now let's look at x squared minus 3x plus 4. All right, now, what's half the middle term?
1.5.
All right, no, it's 3 over 2. It's 3 over 2. Yes, it is 1.5. So this becomes x minus 3 over 2 squared.
I like 1.5 too.
All right, okay. Well, but when you square it, you won't.
Yeah.
Okay, now. So now I need the third term, which will be 3 over 2 times 3 over 2, which will be a positive 9 over 4, and so now I have to subtract 9 over 4. All right, now, again, for me, this is easy, because I know that 4 is the same as 16 over 4. So what's the net result if I have negative 9 and positive 16 all over 4? Oh, sorry, 7 over 4. Yeah, that's ugly. That's ugly, but that's it, too.
I don't like that.
Now, 7 over 4 is 1.75. You could get that off of your butt. To graph it, you're going to have a dot that's going to be below the 2, right? Because most of the time, the size of the dot that you make is going to take up 3 or 4 tenths of the size of those squares, because they're not that big, right? And so to be able to graph this would not necessarily be something that would graph well, because it's not along the line. But how hard was the math? Right. Once you understand it now, do you see why Lee, that I want to do this as a fraction? Because squaring both of those numbers is a whole lot easier than squaring 1.5.
That's true.
Right. Now, 15 times 15 is 225. All right. I happen to know that one, but if it was anything else, I probably wouldn't know it. But I do know 9 over 4. Okay. All right. So, what is that called? That's called completing the square. And we did a little bit of that in Algebra 1, but this is why we had to learn it in Algebra 1, so that now there's a reason for it, because that's how you get the vertex. Okay? Now, so I'm going to take this, and I'm going to give you a vertex form. Okay, where's the vertex? All right, no, it has, it's x minus h plus k, and then so that the h is a 3 in this case. Okay, so I'm going to put a 3, 1, I'm going to put a dot here. Okay, now get your handouts, right, and put a dot right there, at 3, 1. Put a dot at 3, 1. Now, because this is 1, I've already tried to show you what happens if I go over 1. Then I go up 1 squared, which is what? 1. And so that means I have a dot right there. Now, what happens if from that vertex I go back 1? Then negative 1 squared is up 1. So that means I'm right here. Now, if I go over 2 from that vertex, I go up 4, over 2, 1, 2, up, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, if this is the line of symmetry, then watch this. Watch what I'm going to do. Look up here on the board. I've got this dot. How far is it from this line? If that's the line of symmetry, then that's the other point. Because it's a line of symmetry, right?
Right.
Okay. So you don't have to go back and count it all the time once you understand what the process looks like. Okay, now I'm going to change it. We're going to leave that there. Okay, now I'm going to change this to 2. So the vertex is still the same. It's 3, 1. But now I go over 1 up 1 squared times 2. That's over 1 up 2, isn't it? So that puts this right here. And is that the line of symmetry? So where's the other x go? The other x has to go here. Now, over 2, over 2 goes up 4 times 2, which is up 8, right? So if I go over 2, I go up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, which is going to put me right about there, right? And there's my line of symmetry, so this one is going to be right about there. And now, if I graph that, what do you notice?
That's not boring.
All right, so a whole number. There's skinny. If this is greater than 1, it's going to get skinny. The technical term is a stretch. All right, now look at my hands here. If I take the regular graph and I pull it apart like this, what happens to it? It gets skinny. So that term for the change in the graph is called a stretch. What happens if I took that same parabola and I compressed it? It would get fatter, right? And so if this value is between 0 and 1, if it's a fraction that's less than 1, then it's going to compress it and it looks fat. So if A is greater than 1, you have a stretch, right? Which means it gets skinnier, right? If A, and I'm going to use the absolute value of A on these, if the absolute value of A is less than 1, then it compresses and it's fatter. Because what would happen here, I would go over 2 instead of up 4, I might go over 2 up only 1, back 2 up only 1. And then I would go over 3 and up 9 divided by 4, which is only up to a little over 2. And so I have a graph that looks like this, and it's much fatter because it was compressed. Right? So we have stretch, compress. Where's line of symmetry? Alright, how do you find the line of symmetry?
You have to find the vertex.
Alright, so the vertex is right here. What's the line of symmetry? X equals
3.
3 is the line of symmetry. Okay? Right now, that's all the vocabulary that we're going to be getting into when we get into chapter 5. Now, what you're going to be doing for this week is just 5.1 and 5.2. It's not going to have all of those things, but it's going to be getting to introduce you. But this is so important for Algebra 2 that this is a place where we need to slow down, make sure that we've got it, and that we can handle it. Okay? So, let's look at, I'm going to go back one more time. If I give you 4x squared minus 8x plus 11. Okay, if I'm going to complete the square, I have to take these two first terms. Okay, do you see a common number that I can factor out?
4.
I can factor out a 4. So this is really 4 times x squared minus 2x, right? There's my a. What's going to happen to this graph when I graph it?
It's
It's going to stretch because this isn't 1 anymore, it's 4. That make sense? Okay, I mean, it is what it is. Now, the hardest part of completing the square is when this number is not 1. If this number is 1, you just take half the second term. But the first thing I have to do is get the x squared to be 1, so I factor out a 4, and now what's half of this? All right, it'll be negative 1, so now I have 4 parentheses x minus 1 quantity squared. All right, the first term is x squared, the second term is negative 2x, what's the last term? Plus 1, 1 times 1, but now it's 1 times 4. So I have added an extra 4 to the problem. If I add an extra 4, then what do I have to do to that 11? I have to subtract the 4. That makes this plus 7. Now, where's the vertex? 1, comma,
7.
So now, my vertex is at 1, comma, 7. Where's the line of symmetry?
On 7.
X equals 1. 1 is the line of symmetry. This will will stretch by 4 times. So over 1 up 1, now it's over 1 up 1 times 4. Over 2 up 4, now it's over 2 up 4 times 4, which is up 16, is already off the page. Right? Okay, now go back to the original. The y-intercept is what? 0, comma, make the first two zeros. 0, comma, 11. Okay. Now, I have 1, 2 points, and if I go over 1 from here, if I go over 1, I'm up 2, or I'm at 2. If I go up 1 times 4, that makes this 11. If I go back 1, this is at 0, and if I go there up 1 times 4, I'm at 11, and it turns out in this case that these two numbers have to be the same just because they are. Right? Doesn't have to work that way, but it does on this particular case. But I can find a point by over 1 up 1, or over 1 up time up 1 times that. Right now, original. Let's try to bring in negative b over 2a. What is the opposite of b?
8.
8. What's 8 over 2a?
6.
So if I take negative b over 2a, I have the x of the vertex, and I also have the line of symmetry number, using negative b over 2a. Now, how do I find this? I replace 1 in my original equation. And I have 4 subtract 8, negative 4 plus 11 is
7.
So you see how that works? Question about that? All right, now, the reason that I want to take 2 weeks doing this is this is a lot of new information, isn't it? It's taking that old stuff that we worked on last year, and now it's using it for a reason. The reason is to be able to get that graph down. All right, now, if you needed to, how could you find out what the shape of that graph was? Put it in y equals. All right, now get your calculator out. Let's put it in y equals. Oh, man, we're out of time. Okay, let's try to get this finished. Okay, let's put it in y equals. All right, if you look at the graph, okay, do you notice that the graph opens upwards? Alright, we know that because this is positive. Okay, but after you get the graph into y equals, right, so you're gonna have to probably change out. Now what we're gonna do is we're gonna use second calc. Now go to second calc, what do you see? Okay, which way does this open? It opens up. Therefore, the vertex is at where? It's at the minimum value, right? So, is that number four, right?
Minimum is three.
Three, okay, minimum three. So press number three, and then it's gonna ask you a boundary on the left and a boundary on the right. It said, find me the lowest y value in between those two. So move your arrow, get it on the left side, press enter, then move your arrow around, get the cursor on the right side of the vertex, press enter. When you press enter the third time, it'll give you the vertex. And what should it give you? X equals 1, y equals 7. See it? Okay, now that's what we're going to be able to do. So just like with the systems of equations, we could do it by hand, and then we also learned how to do it with a calculator. We're going to learn the same thing. We're going to learn how to do by hand finding the vertex, the line of symmetry, and the y-intercept, and then we're also going to learn how to do it with the calculator so that we have both skills. Okay, and that's the reason why it's going to take an extra week, and we've already caught up. So now we'll be able to slow down a little bit next week, and hopefully that'll begin to sink in and make sense. Okay, look at the teacher page for your assignment, because my mouse is not working, so I can't go back and forth, but yeah. Your assignment is going to be 1 through 7 and 2 through 22, plus the finishing chapter 4. Okay. All right, thank you for a good day. I know we went fast, but I appreciate your attention.